Tundra, fogged. We're getting kind of the switch around with the carriers. This time, Skeeter. He's able to get his hands on the Terra Plate after Picard's had a fantastic game two on it. And this time on the side of EG, Picard, he's going to be kind of bringing in a bit of a lunar flare. You know, something that we see like liquid light to run. Picard, he's going to show that these guys can make it work as well. Let's have a look. Let's see if they can do it here. As outside of that as well, you've got Chris on his Death Prophet. Now, one of the strongest, you were saying last game, that you always like to see him on, taking it to the mid.
He executed incredibly well last game. I mean, they literally just destroyed Nine. He didn't really get to play until, I mean, somehow he did get to play, but they shut him down super hard that he barely did get to play his own game. And yeah, I think for EG, this is a lineup that they have to get ahead and stay ahead on. I think if they start falling behind in this one at Tundra, they have a super good draft. It's very comfort for them. It's literally their bread and butter. Ench TB, DK on Nine, 33 playing the Tide. Soxa slash Aramis playing the Snapfire, so I think for this top lane in particular, Picaz and the Silencer, they have to really shut down this Tide. It can sometimes be that good lane with the Lunar Blessing that can do decent. Not with the Silencer so much, but like a Rubick Luna, I've seen them do very well versus the Tide, but 33, he's a different form of Tide. I've seen him always do well. The battle begins. Yeah, I'm with the panel on this one. I like the way the Tundra set things up here, but if EG they're able to play and get ahead, then perhaps we can see some magic happen. But I'm just not the biggest believer in Lion and Silencer supports anymore, even though I know it's their bread and butter. But let's see what we get.
Last game, we had some crazy stuff happening pretty early on with EG getting that early lead with how rough things were for Nine in the mid lane. This time around on the DK, very unlikely that anything's going to cause any crazy struggles for the Dragonite early. Should be a pretty solid lane from both of them, unlikely to see either dying.
Yeah, Nine should just be able to farm. They did the level one creep thing down bottom with the Doom. They just stood on the wave. They killed the range creep immediately so that he gets a good start in the lane playing versus the HTB. Nice little prep there for EG to make sure the Whisper gets something. And Picaz, he takes a quick beating up top. So as we said, Tundra, I feel like they just have the best understanding of how to play with Tidehunter. Personally, even though if they sometimes can pick it into a quote-unquote tougher lane, he always just knows what to do.
Let's see how strong this lane does feel for Tundra. Once again, just having the power of snaking on the Enchantress will create ample amounts of space for Skeeter.
I mean, Skeeter should tree farm down here. Unless there's some big mistakes. Nay, maybe he can give up a couple deaths depending on what creep Whisper finds, but at the moment right now, not available. Yeah, I feel like Nine also, I think this is actually Nine's best hero, as boring as it sounds overall. I think he's just so stable, so comfortable on it. I've seen him win matchups in super disadvantageous positions. I like DK versus Timber and he gets the kills and stuff like that, so he should be just fine versus Chris. I mean, this is also probably Chris's best hero. That's why we see it banned so much, but tough to bully out of DK.
Bottom lane.
It's actually Matthew who's found. Yeah, this is a tough position to be in. In this bottom lane. Yeah, TP just felt like a perfect answer to pretty much everything that he saw. Like, great versus DP, great versus Doom, great versus Luna if he gets this free farm. So yeah, I think for EG, they have to get ahead and stay ahead somehow.
We're going to try and fight back at snaking, but got to be careful with the metamorphosis still going there for Skeeter. He's able to get a good couple of hits in onto Matthew again.
He has to be very careful.
Salve up here on the line.
Radiant's courier has been killed.
We'll find the courier. Always does tend to be able to do so, Matthew. Get these courier snipes regardless of what hero he's playing.
Of course, always versus the carries as well. It's not the support courier, as we always say, that goes down. These carries, just never careful with it. Money changes hands.
Top lane so far. Solid farm here for 33.
Yeah, he's got Ring of Health now, too. Stun, we'll connect. Every time meta's available, there is definitely a kill threat down here for the side of Tundra. And MP9 is, I didn't expect him to be completely owning the matchup, though. And right now, he definitely is. 22-5 to the 14-0. As you said, this is his best hero. Treads already finished up, but now he's got huge base damage advantage over Chris. constant breathe fire puts him low. Sounser steps up.
They should have him there. We'll lose some beam. What? See, that's going to be enough to save. Just a bit of a mini stun there to stop 33 getting in a couple more right clicks. And it's going to be fine. Pekaz able to help out.
Pekaz quickly gets anchor smashed. And looking at Pekaz's game overall, he's playing into one of those counter matchups. He's playing versus the Terrorblade, and he's also playing into two different forms of damage reduction. Anchor smash plus the breathe fire. Definitely feels like it's going to be a difficult game for him, because it's going to be like, when does he want to use Manta? Does he want to use Manta when he's Reflectioned? Does he want to use Manta if he gets hit by Anchor Smash? Does he want to use Manta when he gets hit by one of these other ones? It's not easy for him.
Yeah, quite a few stuns to catch him out as well.
Oh my, Matthew almost dies to the Warpine Raider. It's a rough lane for them down here.
Yeah, he's having to burn through quite a bit of regen to stick around in this bottom lane, Matthew, to try and help out Whisper.
And honestly, it's mostly just snaking and zoning the two of them. This isn't even like meta being popped. It's just an illusion being thrown and just the creep that snaking's able to have to push him away. Chris, trying to get aggressive here, using that glyph.
Yeah, we'll keep 9 low, but not quite enough damage at this stage for Chris really to burst for the kill.
Oh, and he's still free farming. Top, can they find Aramis? Not quite.
At bottom lane.
Meta's available.
And they're ready to kill again. Matthew goes down. Whisper will be fine, but still taking a heavy beating.
Tundra looking real hot in these three lanes. How's the levels looking for 9? He's about to hit 6, and he can just pop the dragon form and hit Chris.
Can trade back and start to pressure in on the mid.
That's the last siphon also for 20 seconds, so he can just get this push going a little bit here. Chris will have the water rune at the least up top to be able to fill himself back up. But they're just going to start hitting tower and snaking. I mean, he probably got the memo from 9. Hey, make a rotation over with your creep. They can get some good tower damage here, potentially.
Top lane, Matthew and Panda. They'll get Aramis. Matthew comes in with the rotation, looks to help out.
He probably feels like he's not doing anything down bottom anyway. He's like, I'm not touching Terrorblade, and Doom is not really getting any farm anyway, so I think this is what he has to do.
And then the supports, they'll swing over towards mid to see if they can help out here as well. Just sort of push back Tundra from heading onto the Tier 1. Still a fair bit of damage done with this first round of Elder Dragonform. Already half the HP of the Tier 1 tower taken.
It's down to a third. Super low already. Good rotation from Snay. I mean, he knows he wasn't needed down bottom anymore for this TB to just get absolute free farm. Now he's going to walk into the jungle as well. He's going to get the scout information of this triangle and take a creep for himself.
I guess the D ward as well. Before Matthew's able to put him to a stop with the stun.
No funny business from Tundra this time. They're not running no DK support. They're playing their literal bread and butter lineup. DK form back up in about 15 seconds. I mean, Chris, he's looking to... It looks like he's like wants to maybe move, but then he's like, oh my god, wait, if I leave the mid lane, the tower's just dead. So has to go right back toward it. And let's see if they do a double rotation with the supports again to try to set up for 9. Aramis, though, he's actually the one joining, and there's the DK form. They're pinging it out. Can they punish it?
Well, Matthew's here. Got the ghost.
He just walks away.
And the cookie's there to make sure the 9 is far enough away that Matthew will not be able to get the catch on him.
Chris, gonna take quite a bit of damage here.
Him? Oh my goodness, they nearly do.
If they had cookie, he used it before, of course, to save him, but Jesus, Chris, be careful.
He'll have to deny his tower. That's an early time for this tier 1 to be taken off the map. In fact, 9.
They're going back in. Matthew's here.
Cookie in from Aramis, but the siphon was off from Chris, so he's healing up.
Should find Aramis here.
Got a fairy fire Aramis, but nothing else. So get one more scatter blast out, but he goes down. We'll see if they can find Chris in return. They can't. Chris heals up and he's backing away.
Snay, the bounces.
Well, they're turning towards Panna instead, see if they can get the two supports. There's 9. Continue to chase down Panda. Dragon Tail's back up. They'll get the kill out of this.
Rune spawns bottom. Unfortunate there for Chris. Tundra, they're kind of cruising forward here in this one. Easy tower. Threatening and forcing rotations constantly.
I mean, we have both carries getting pretty much free farm, but Skeeter just getting that little bit more so far.
And he's got that better core-to-core matchup too. Whisper, nice little tornado pull.
Chris is going to swing over towards the bottom lane. A Looks a snaking. He's able to get the heals off.
Chris.
Gotta be careful. They've got the scatter blast on to Chris. Nine. He's in as well with the dragon tail. Gets the angle for the brief fire out onto the two of them. As both go down, Chris and Matthew taken out. And the space is now here for Tundra to take this tier one, or at least put the pressure on.
Hey, this is devastating for a Death Prophet. It's a DP versus a DK matchup. Loses his tower. Tries to make a rotation. Dies. He's only level six. They're going to lose a secondary tower also. Tundra off to a phenomenal start. Dire's bottom tower has fallen. And 33 is just alone. Free farming as well. Difficult now with the position that this DP's in. It's really hard for Chris to really pressure almost anything, right? Like, no matter where he's going to turn up to go for some type of pressure play, there's going to be responses. There's going to be damage for him. Tundra has done such a good job of shutting him down. First Exorcism got, like, pretty much zero damage onto the tower. Dire's top tower is under attack. I'm waiting to see if 9 does go for the blink. We've seen him a bunch of times have this and just goes for the Midas. The rotation for Pakaz is coming in. They can't go for him. Too tanky. And he finds a regen. Everything going Tundra's way this game. Farm the stack together, give Aramis some XP to get that 6. I believe he's got the tome. So he will have 6. So yeah, Chris has to be very careful. A stun into some kisses. DP's in trouble.
See how quickly they can get out with the smoke move here, 9 and Aramis.
I mean, they've got one on them. They've got the blink. Okay, it's not on him yet.
It's coming out
on the courier. Doesn't feel the need to be greedy with the way that everything's going on 9. Dire's top tower has fallen. Got the two supports behind. Not quite 6 on either, so no global to counter the kisses. Yeah, there's the blink delivery.
See if they can jump. See if they can get the wraparound on this mid lane, get behind Chris.
Hey, Whisper's got his Midas, but we'll be able to use it on the catapult. If he steps up, he's looking pretty dead.
He's playing careful, though.
He is. He knows something's up. I mean, look at Chris as well, too. Chris is sitting at the tier 2.
I mean, they know that the timing's going to be there from 9 and that he's off the map.
They've got global available now, too, so they have a way to stop the kisses when it comes out. Tons of pressure being mounted, though, from Tundra. Chris literally sat at the tier 2 there for 45 seconds, not even farming a jungle camp. Now he will step up forward since they have that global to protect.
Pakaz still won't be ready to turn up to a fight, really, until he has the BKB done.
Cute little tumble play. And I believe 33, I think he has his pipe already finished coming out on the courier.
They're getting ready to get aggressive inside of EG's own jungle.
Chris. Snail will poke him.
Yeah, back up in the form of Whisper comes over. TP's in. EG. They've got the numbers here as well.
Their form of initiation is very awkward, though. It's like Matthew has to just kind of charge in and throw away his life in order to get one.
And there's a full pipe on 33.
Super tanky. Pakaz does have the point in Eclipse. They will push them out of the jungle, but I think Tundra's pretty happy with that. I mean, Skitter is literally just getting to farm the enemy triangle here. That's like the dream here for Tundra. Two supports trying to make a move onto him. Don't be mad. Matthew. Actually, perhaps getting a good wraparound here. They get the Doom. They should find him.
Now looking very, very dead hit. I get the finger stack.
Nicely done.
Tundra, at least in response, will immediately try and get the pressure onto the tier 2, popping the dragon form here, 9.
Pakaz, and he'll have access to his triangle here too, so he'll be able to keep up with the net worth of the TB. Can Chris get an exorcism onto the tower here? Maybe a bit afraid to. Radiant's middle tower is under this tower, it's like more less than half HP already.
Matthew's hit.
Quite a bit has been committed already, though, from EG and Matthew. The kisses. They'll pop the global, but can he actually get away?
Oh, he's actually going to live, Matthew.
All righty.
Backup's coming in.
Here comes Chris.
Chris is in with the ghost. Aramis will be able to cookie up to the high ground. Chris turns his attention over towards 9 instead.
Whoops.
And if Matthew gets a little too close, 9's able to turn, take him out with a brief fire. Also able to get the Dragon Tail stun off. The Siphons bringing 9 low.
No
the
way.
Ghost, they'll finish him off. 9 goes down.
Great tornado play. Whisper, he actually hurricanes Chris forward to get on top of 9. Nice done. Matthew does walk in and take a stray breathe fire, though, and does end up dying at the end of it all, but they get the bigger kill.
I mean, does that feel good enough, though, for EG? Using the ghost, using the global, you just get one kill.
No, not really. I mean, Pekaz is getting space, so sure. They're probably like, okay, whatever, Luna's farming, so we're happy. But top tower, it's almost just dead here. What else can they make?
Tundra's going to try and get straight back on it here with 33 shoving in this top lane.
Chris feels the need to just go first item BKB. I don't blame him.
Dire's top tower is under attack. If they can go again. Still 30 seconds until Whisper has Doom back up.
They'll pop the glyph, Matthew. Can't quite line up the stun.
And Matthew's got to be a bit careful. They might just be able to go for him.
He has ward coverage at the least, so he does C9 if he's approaching. But yeah, tier 2 drops 15 minutes in.
Just a bit of a race for Pekaz to get that BKB before he's forced to fight, and he's close. Matthew.
They will definitely have a pretty, like, good timing of the triple BKBs hitting together to
Absolutely.
Perhaps deal with that
yeah.
big, overwhelming teamfight that Tundra has.
And sort of in these fights as well, will it very much be a case of kind of pop BKB, try and kill the Terrorblade while she went under the coverage of the BKB, or do you go for the quick, easy kills under the supports? You know, what's going to be top of EG's list?
Hey, just pop BKBs and survive. If they can just survive the initial go, then perhaps they can chase out a lot of these core heroes. The ideal target, of course, is that Terrorblade and Tundra. They actually find a DD top. I believe it was scouted from the Illusion. Could look to threaten Orochi pretty soon. Yeah, Dire's already throwing the scan out. Skitter finds the DD. He's got meta. What does he look to hit? I'd imagine it's the Roche. Yeah, it's going to be that. EG, how's the timing? BKB's finished on Chris.
I mean, they're pretty sure, and they've got all their ultimates up, EG.
Pekaz is just far, and it's going to drop pretty quick here. Pekaz, I don't know. He's sure, BKB's coming. Let's see.
I mean, it's looking like they won't make it.
Don't think so.
They're not going to be able to put a stop to this. Tundra, they're getting the Roche. And EG just not quite set up. Even though those timings, they were there. They just got the BKBs delivered. But I guess just a moment too late, as it wasn't at a time where they could make the sort of the coordinated move to get over towards that Roche and contest it. Skeeter, he's able to grab the Aegis.
I mean, sometimes this happens, right? You scan, it doesn't end up clipping, and then a DD spawns outside Roche. And Tundra's just like, oh, a blessing. Thank you. Tundra. They're going to try to poke and perhaps force BKBs. That's kind of the next thing that they want to try to do before they take a straight head-on fight. Pekaz is very ready to battle. Dropo is online for the Luna. Level 2 Eclipse and the Max Lucent Beam as well.
They want to try and fight EG despite the fact that there's this Aegis on Skeeter. It's a risky call. But they still, do feel strong with these BKBs.
Still tough for them to get full initiations onto the cores. Still gets Nay.
As always, he's the one to tank it. And in fact, he doesn't end
he's
up dying straight
alive.
Away. He's able to get the heals off. They use the finger for that as well, but they won't quite get him. Snake King's healing up. Chris, he'll put the ghost. He'll charge straight in on the action.
But Snake's
now there's
still alive.
To fight him, and the Metamorphs is up for Skeeter. Chris has to put the BKB to run.
Pekaz, he gets stunned.
And he's caught by the Dragon Tail Ravage as well. Pekaz is dead.
Uh-oh.
They just went for it a bit too hard there. They really tried to force the fight, EG. It cost them the two lives, and it cost them the big one as well. Pekaz gets taken out. Not a chance to pop his BKB in that one.
I mean, Snay just runs in, and he's actually just too tanky for them to bring down, even with a finger. Hutton bounties. Dire's middle tower. Tier 2, another one.
We'll see it again. I mean,
I can't believe they can't even finish him.
They're very good at this Tundra where Mistaken's on the Enchantress. So many times he's the one to sort of tank just the attention and the focus. And they really wanted to make this work. Chris committing him with the Exorcism. And as you see, I think we're sort of all the focus behind the Tier 2 Picard. He wasn't ready to get clipped from this other angle.
No, Nine just gets in his face. And they do end up using Global. They use Finger, they use Exo, and they get literally nothing out of it. The pipe coverage there from 33, perfect to protect Snaking. Snay the Master Raider. He does this so much for them.
You just can't go on this Enchantress.
No.
You've got to find some way around it. If you see the Enchantress, you've got to kind of call it bail. Bail on the fight. Committing to a fight when you're dropping spells on Snaking just never feels good when you're playing against Tundra.
I mean, EG probably just felt forced because they have triple BKB. They're like, yeah, we got to make something happen with this, but yeah, Tundra, they're like, okay, thank you. He actually just walked right into us. Wraith Pact now done for 33. Even more damage reduction. As we said, Breathe Fire, Anchor Smash, now a Wraith Pact as well.
I'm thinking about going on the time.
Get the Doom on him.
Get the Eclipse as well. It's a lot of damage.
It's a good one.
If they can catch more, looking towards Aramis, they will. A snap fire. Also to fall, EG finally able to find that move that they hoped for. A take out two, and they're able to push in and not lose anything themselves.
They didn't use any of their BKBs either, too, which is nice for the upcoming engagement. Keeping Picaz pretty much the same net worth as the Terra Blade. The next item, though, for Skitter, that's going to be the devastating one versus that ranged carry. Terra Blade versus Luna, just getting that benefit from the aura. Scotty will be about 2,000 gold away from him. Tundra, they've got everything back up. They've got the Ravage. Probably going to look to hit. There's a Global and an Exorcism available. I don't think Tundra minds. They're going to just try to go through this. Matthew, be a bit careful with his positioning here.
Only so much the supports can do to try and slow this Panda.
Ooh, nice try.
He's going to get out. Aramis not able to find the angle for the cookie. But the Tier 2 tower's taken down. Tundra, they'll keep the push going. They've still got the Ravage available on 33.
I mean, they're just going to keep going.
He's going to pop the meta.
There's no Glyph available. That's why they're pushing so hard.
I think they jump on the silencer. That's Panda out for 30 seconds.
Because?
He's trying to back away, but he gets caught by the slow. The damage is coming in. He has to put the BKB to run.
I mean, there's no Glyph. They used it for the Tier 2. There will be one for the Rax, but Tundra, they're just pushing right through. They're like, no Doom, we don't care. Good luck fighting into our Tide.
I mean, what do EG do here? We might just have to let this mid-Rax go.
Eclipse sure
is going to be up in a couple of seconds from Picard.
I mean, Tundra still has Ravage. They're looking to keep going. They're punishing that cooldown of the Doom. It's 10 seconds till it's back up.
And nine. Ooh, jumps in, Matthew.
Nice so play.
Protects himself there with the Shard and turns with the stun.
Tundra, they're going to back away.
They're going to try and chase it. Chris, got the Exorcism ready to attempt to run 33 down. Come with the Scatter Blast. Now the BKB comes out from Chris.
He faked the Ravage, though. He's going to have it up. Can they get 9?
Whisper's going to get the jump into the tree lines. They'll find the Dragon Knight. Doom gets locked down onto 9. They'll be able to cookie him to safety and
force
away.
Him.
They're saving him. 9's going to be able to walk away from this. That's an Exorcism of Doom. Multiple BKBs used by EG here, but they don't find anything with them.
EG finds literally nothing, and now the Scotty's finished. Because he just bails. He's like, get me out of here. Tundra, I mean, they still have Ravage.
That's a lot of cooldowns used by EG.
They're just playing. They're playing that so clean there on Tundra. They're like, oh, 9 gets doomed. Okay, whatever. Cooking him out. They've got 4 staffs as well. Snaking's got max heal. Just sits on top of him.
I mean, Chris just wants to sort of charge in and run at them, but in terms of just the overall lockdown from EG's heroes, it's not really there. They really struggle to kind of just keep someone in position on Tundra so that Chris and Picard can focus them down. And now with the jump up to the high ground, they get the catch on Matthew.
This is the problem with having like this lion and just complete lack of initiation with your draft, the lack of catch.
And Picard.
You gotta be careful. Whisper.
Whisper. Towards Snaking, but there's just so much sustain and heal here from Tundra.
Picard!
He's able to get the jump on Picard. They have to come in with the global to keep Picard safe.
but it's a global into an instant disengage from Tundra. Now they're going back in.
They're absolutely ready to go once more. Illusion rune. The Terror Blade gets cookied in on top of Chris. As Chris, he's out without buyback. 40 seconds, no death profit. Tundra, they'll keep this push going.
That's another axe for sure. There's just nothing EG can do. Tundra just cleanly playing this perfectly. Like, nicely resetting, knowing when to jump in and get the catch.
Nine. He's gonna get on top of Whisper. Whisper, and we're forced away from the base, back in the base. I mean, Skeeter, he's in on top of Panda. Panda, not a chance against the damage of the Terror Blade at this stage.
And Picard, if he just gets stunned, he's dead.
I mean, they're just looking onto the tier fours now. 24 minutes in, Tundra.
There's just no hope. EG, they're going to have to try to buy back. It's 24 minutes, Owen.
What, nine? That's caught by the Hex. Buybacks have come out from Panda. Tundra. And one of the tier fours pretty much taken out Picard. He's looking for nine.
Nice dodge.
Just the Dragon Tail here with the Manta style. They're on top of nine, but the BKB's there. Nine. He's out of the fight.
And they still can't commit. I mean, there's no Doom, so 33 is just parking himself in front of them. He's got the Ravage at the ready. I mean, this is a total dismantling. There's like... what does EG do? They're just getting outscaled, outplayed, everything across the board.
It's a lot of farm on Picard, but just a difficult game to sort of play as the Luna, especially when you're behind the Terror Blade in farm.
Yes, you have to be. That's what I was saying. Like, when you have to kind of just be ahead with this draft. And honestly, like, Chris, he's super far behind as this Death Prophet. He's level 12. I'm looking at the levels from the side of, like, Tundra. The Enchantress is level 12. That's how farmed they are at the moment. And they're just in the base.
And they just... The catch isn't there.
There just is no catch.
You know, they're all ready to go. They're ready to fight, but... There's nobody to just hold any of Tundra in position. Tundra, they can just back out at their own will.
They're toying with them. It really is that. I mean, until Matthew has like a blink, there's just no way for them to get these type of blink stuns, blink initiations, nothing like that.
And even if they do find it now, it could get tripped up. I mean, the Lotus Orb's complete on 33.
Mm-hmm. And there's a Rosh up. And I believe Skitter, he has BKB now after the Scotty already finished up with Grobo. So he's just going to disintegrate this Luna from a distance that she can't get to. Very clean Dota from Tundra this game.
And with this Aegis, highly likely that Tundra will have everything they need to close this one up.
Yep, just going to shove bottom. They already have top and mid cleared out. Snaking, he's going to start getting the push going. Takes a range creep, and they're going to go meet him. And still nowhere near the Blink Dagger onto Matthew. Still nowhere to start fights. Tundra they're just finishing up these last, like, they're just picking up some small items here. Even a Vitality Booster now for 33. It's all these little things just because they know this is time to end.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Ooh, and it looks like they're drawing a bit of a clever line if they do want to go for this. A wrap through the mid lane to the bottom. Don't know if it's necessary. They probably can just walk in. Meta's popped. The stun. Now Whisper.
Straight away. They get the jump on the Doom. The global silence will come out. As Whisper, he's going to try and keep himself safe. I believe it's been Glimmer. They don't have detection. So Whisper will actually get away from Tundra.
Tower's dropping, though. Nine waiting in the wings for the jump.
That was the global. Now a lot harder to put a stop to this push. I mean, the tier three's gone. They've got to do something, EG.
How do they approach this, though? I mean, Chris?
He's going to put the BKB, but still it's just so much physical coming out from Skeeter. Matthew will land the stun. Now get the Doom drop down onto Skeeter. Of course, he's got that Aegis. Even if they can get him the once, he's going to be back for round two. And he will have the BKB and Manta ready to pop on the respawn. As he's back in nine, he'll come in with a BKB. There's the Ravage from 33, comes in, hits the four of them. Only Whisper able to dodge it with his BKB. As Picard is out for a minute, he gets the stun on the Chris. Chris will get the ghost out, but he's getting forced away from the barracks. Tundra, they can look to claim the Megas.
They played this one flawlessly. Yeah, GG, EG. They had no hope in this one from start to finish. Nine, yeah, honestly, everybody across the board, perfect performance. Enchantress rotation to mid, Nine wins mid, TB's free farming, Tide's free farming. This was easy for Tundra.
Yeah, a difficult one for EG. They just never got that lead, never got that timing where Picard would have been able to pop off as a Luna. Just, yeah, too much of a strong game from Skeeter. And far, far ahead pretty much for the entirety of it all. And yeah, the pieces just didn't fall together for EG this time. Chris not able to get away with as much aggression as he did in that game two where he popped off as the Bat. This time around as the Death Prophet. It seemed like every single time, Tundra, they were just able to walk away from him.
Yep, they had no catch. None whatsoever. I mean, this is multiple times now. They've gone for this Lion Silencer. I know in their region, they've made it work and stuff like that. Even Silencers, I think, first two picks some of the times in their region. But, I mean, Tundra, they had all the answers. So he said, little to no mistakes. Clean game from them.
Absolutely. Well, there we go, ladies and gentlemen. With that victory here in Game 3, Tundra, they'll take the series.